this is what I found, is I used to get tripped up on all these continuity issues. I mean, on these level confusion issues. Level confusion, you know. It's like, ah, that bothers me. Wait a minute. I could look at, if I looked at it this way, it's okay. If I look at it this way, it's not okay. Which is the right way? All this kind of stuff. It could just be a real agitation. But now you just ignore it. It's just no problem at all. It's just the price we pay for an education, you know, for a spiritual education. Needing to use words still. The point beyond words. We then don't make an effort to confound ourselves. We can always confound ourselves if we want to. So it's a given that the listener is not trying to confound themselves. The hearer is not trying to confound themselves. It's a given. So I just keep on going. I don't worry about it. It's a given. It has to be a given. Otherwise, there's no student listening at all. A student is not trying to confound themselves. They're trying to not be confounded and let the potential of being confounded, let it go, let it go. You know, the reluctant student is easy to see, like a piano lesson, you know, if they don't want to learn, they can pretend and say, no, wait a minute, you know, you said hit C note C here, and then you set it up there, but you didn't say, you know, which one is this. It's always easy to, if you want to confound yourself, make the teacher look stupid or inept, to cover your own laziness. It's always easy to do that, easy. So the good student, the real student, is not looking to confound themselves and not trying to project their laziness onto the teachers. They were teachers and them, because they're teaching all this level, things that are conflicted, level confusion here. I see all this confusion. No, they're saying, no. The teacher's not lazy. The teacher's doing a good job. And I'm not lazy. I'm doing a good job. So I'm not going to, it's like water off the duck's back. I'm not going to be bothered by potential, you know, conflict of words, of symbols. We're just keeping it loose so we can see past the symbols, that's all. Ultimately, we go beyond it. No need. That's all understood. We sort of have the cult of the bad student in this world, where everyone, all the lazy people gather together into a cult and then insist that it's the teacher that is lazy, because what they're teaching is confounding them. It's amazing how adept some people are at claiming they're being confounded by the most simple stuff. I don't understand this. It's, what, how do you do this? I've tried, I can't do this. This is so confounding. It's, what do you mean? You know, it's like a switch, turn it on. I can't get this to work. I've tried everything. It's so impossible. I mean, I just can't, is there some way, have you tried turning the switch on? Huh, what? No, I tried, I couldn't do that. I was so confident. This is the cult of cult of confoundment is what I've run into in this world. And this is something that is very, very strongly practiced. So people become geniuses at it, actually. So they can claim as the teacher is to blame, or that what the teacher's teaching is way too difficult to understand. You know, how do I get off through this confusion and confoundment? There isn't any confoundment unless you insist upon it. You see. So what they want to do is make the confoundment real and then get rid of it, which is duality, which is the whole problem. As I've said, trying to make illusions real and then get rid of them, that is delusion. That's the delusion that we're in. As they're saying, yeah, we got to make disempowering of God real, and then when we make it real, then we can get rid of it, and then God is not disempowered. This is the delusion that we suffer from. And so it goes all, percolates all the way down to every interaction we have in this world, actually. Every little thing. I'm so confounded, you know. It's that they're so adept at insisting on being confounded by something that is not confounding at all. But the potential, the insist on words, which the potential for confoundment is always present. So, it's like you're walking on a narrow path. The potential there is to get off the path at any time. But also the potential is there to stay on the narrow path. Narrow and straight is the way. And it's easy to get off the path if you want to. Words bring about a very narrow path, of course. Concepts, thinking, thoughts, all that stuff, very narrow path. But you have to realize you're on a narrow path. Be very careful. Don't stray off the path. Narrow path. Don't let level confusion agitate you. Realize if it's agitating you, you have a continuity problem. But most people here have such a severe continuity problem, a lack of familiarity, that even the slightest little tremor, you know, is enough for them to lapse into level confusion. Level confusion and talking points. It's just poof, instantly. The hermit crab back in its shell. Level confusion and talking points immediately. Full armament, you know, defensiveness comes out. So remedy, monastic culture, for sure. Living in a culture by osmosis, they gradually, after a lifetime of that, they won't be so quick to jump into level confusion. Like, oh, here's a way to get off the path. Let me go into the jungle off this path. Oh, I'm lost in the jungle. I'm so lost. I don't see any path. Where's the path? Well, you were just on it, but you decided to veer off into the jungle. No, I didn't. The path disappeared. Path ended. I didn't see, you know, no, come help. I'm trapped. This is terrible. You didn't tell me this was happening to me. You led me astray into this jungle. I said, no, you just veered right off the path. No, I didn't see. The path ended. I just... No, I did not. This was the path. I thought I saw the path. No, it was obvious. Here's the path, and here's the jungle. This is completely obvious. No. I'm very confused. How could I do, you know, like this? This is the way the world is. And I'll spend, you know, hours consisting. No, I didn't. The answer is to say, okay, I experienced a continuity fear, which caused me to defend against going any further, so that's why I veered off the path. You said, oh, okay, I veered off the path because of the continuity fear. Diffused, right like that. Settle yourself wherever you are. Calm down, full stop on the wow, because the good news is getting a little too severe. Say, okay, get used to wherever you are. Then say, okay, let me look for the path again. Oh, there it is. Just look through the bushes here. Oh, okay, now I see. Oh my gosh, the path is obvious right there. It's not that narrow. I mean, it's right completely delineated. Very delineated. So, oh, I'm back on the path now. And then you keep going. This is what happens. But in a monastic, theological place of worship, monastic, religious culture, this is part of the whole situation. People realize this. There's lots of teachers, lots of counselors, lots of people helping with the severe, you know, problem. It's a continuity problem. This is the problem we have. The good news. We're too afraid of the good news. The good news is that we're perfect. The good news is that we can't be disempowered. And the good news is that doesn't disempower God at all. There's no such thing as any disempowerment. Never. No such situation whatsoever. And we see that and say, oh my gosh, I don't need to... and drop all of this. And go, whoops, that's too good for me. It's too perfect. Wait a minute. Let me veer off into the jungle somewhere. And then scream, you led me astray. You terrible teacher, you led me astray. But here we immediately say, it's a continuity problem. Just center yourself in the continuity problem and take responsibility for that. See, you realize it's a declaration. It's a path of declaring, being repentant. See, I have a very severe problem. I have one problem only, but it's a very, very severe problem. It's the continuity problem. And when you own that, when you have a repentant mind, it's amazing, it's miraculous what happens. Is you quickly get back on the path. You say, whoops, okay, I didn't full stop on the wow, but now this wow enough. I got a little off track. Okay, and I have a continuity problem, it's the only problem I have. You keep saying that, you calm down. I don't have a jungle lost problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have an end of the path problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have an inept teaching or teacher problem, I have a continuity problem. own the continuity problem, and you find yourself centered very quickly. Sometimes it happens like in 5 seconds, 5 seconds, sometimes more, but it can happen very quickly. You suddenly feel a shift, you feel centered, and say, oh, okay, I wandered off the path again, no problem. I know it's just right over there, easy to get back on it. Problem solved. And then you start making more progress. So you go very rapidly on the path when you're repentant mind, mood of repentance, I call it the mood of repentance. Tremendous time saver. So you couple that with a monastic culture, and you're going to be very successful, have a tremendous spiritual path. And ultimately you will succeed for sure. So these are the keys. Those are the two keys. A theocratic, religious, place of worship, monastic culture. And the focus is on the continuity problem with mood of repentance. A mood of repentance culture, recognizing the continuity problem, the problem of familiarity, the problem of the good news. It's too much for us. We're not familiar with it. We're scared of it. It's a continuity problem. Put those two together, and you will be aware of the progress that you're making. You will be aware of it, actually. And you'll just say, wow. And that in itself will be a wow, which you need to get used to. You need to get used to rapid progress, which is definitely a wow. Like the fourth phase here, the progress has been so rapid, it's a constant wow for me. Way faster than the phase one, two, or three. Dramatically faster. And so, of course, I'm just like, holy cow. This is just racing towards the finish line here. It's like a sprint to the finish line. Then you realize, hey, this whole race is going to be over a lot sooner than I thought. And it's like, wow. I'm getting real close now. Wow. So that's the fourth phase. So this is a cosmic perspective. This is a cosmic perspective because this is dealing with spirit and the mind and this cosmic delusion. At its very root. At its very root is a continuity problem. At its very root, it's an absurdity that we need to, that there's no real problem at all, and that's what freaks us out. We say, well, no, I need some real problems. Let me cause a lot of problems in my life and make sure I got some real problems. But because we're afraid, we see, well, there is no real problem. It's an absurdity. That if I don't find out how to disempower God, God's going to be disempowered, you know? As if he was unable to create a creation as if God created us to disempower God. And therefore, if we fail to disempower God, that means God didn't have the power to empower us to disempower God. So that will disempower God. This is the conundrum that is sticking, causing us to suffer, actually. This is the conundrum. We believe God created us to disempower God. So if we fail to disempower God, that is the disempowerment of God, because God didn't empower us properly to disempower God. You see that? So the way to solve it is to say God did not create us to disempower God. Not at all. God created us completely free to entertain any and all ideas and you know, ideas possible. And so one idea is, hey, maybe we can be greater than God. I wonder if we can try to be great. Well, we're free to try. We're free to try. Maybe we can disempower ourselves. Well, we're free to try, but we can't. Okay? But we cannot. So we did. We tried to do so. Again, we believe that we believe God created us on a mission. Our purpose is to disempower God. And so if we fail at that, that means that God's creativity is inadequate. And that means that God is not all-powerful. And so God has been disempowered. So we feel that to disempower God is to affirm God's power. You see? So we saved God from disempowerment by disempowering God. Now, if this completely freaks you out, okay, fine. I just say it doesn't freak me out at all. Okay. Very clear. No problem. It does not generate any thoughts or confusion or panic or anything. Just like to see it, the whole situation. Okay, fine. Just look. Don't do anything about it. Just notice it. That's all right. So it is possible to see this without, you know, just freaking out. Yeah. And this is what Jesus leads us to, saying, hey, you know, you need to look at the root of it, the absurdity at the root of it. Just look at it. Somehow he says when you recognize illusions for what they are, they disappear. That's what he said. So maybe this will disappear for me. I hope so. Because what else can you do for it to disappear? There's nothing to solve. We've already seen the complete absurdity of it. Wrong premises that God created us with the purpose of some specific purpose. That is the mistake. God did not create us with any specific purpose. God created us as pure freedom. Non-specific, indeterminate. Okay? Not for some mission. We were not created with some mission. Not at all. We had this idea that, you know, of this nonsense. So hopefully it will evaporate. Jesus says, you see illusions as they are, it evaporates them. Don't have to do anything else. So just stay in the full stop of the now, the wow of this, and this evaporates it. Don't struggle. Just keep seeing the illusion. Clarify and see the illusion as it is, and the sea says the seeing of it, that's what evaporates. That's what evaporates, and the seeing of it. Not the thoughts. Your thoughts don't evaporate. Your thinking doesn't evaporate. Your concatenations and verbalizations, etc., do not evaporate it. Reifications, and then the working with all those reifications do not evaporate it. It's simply the seeing of it evaporates it inherently. Very funny situation happened today. I was just thinking yesterday about, you know, this blasty culture and how we have to try to push through this, then the full stop and then now this wow. And I was thinking, yeah, you know, coffee's really bad and sodas are really, caffeine's bad. And I said, yeah, you know, Red Bull, we're in a Red Bull culture. I said, Red Bull's horrible for you. It's terrible. And so many people now are using Red Bull and energy drinks. In fact, it's now constantly in our culture talking about, oh yeah, yeah, oh, it's great, you know, that's pushing up when you push through and stuff. And it's like totally acceptable now in culture. And it's just like, wow, this is like horrible. This is just, you know, this shows how bad things have gotten. So I'm somewhere today. And this is a true story. I mean, this is just, it's so amazing. It's just like, wow. And someone that I know is an acquaintance and was working at a place that I go to, and they saw me and they just said, hey, you want something here? And it was this refrigerator of drinks. You want something here? I said, well, yeah, you want something, right? And I said, well, I don't know. And they said, here, they opened it up. And they grabbed the soda can and picked it out and gave it to me. Here, gave it to me. I said, oh, wow. What was it? It was a Red Bull. It was a tall can of sugar-free Red Bull. Gave it to me. Huh. I said, wow, this is weird. This is very strange. Just thinking about how bad real Red Bull is, and somebody just gifts me a Red Bull out of the blue. I mean, how many times you had somebody just say, hey, here, take this, and just gift you a product or something out of a store. There's a store, they just gifted me this thing. I said, wait a minute, you have to pay for it? No, here, take it. That's what happened today. Just after last night, thinking about how terrible Red Bull is. So I have this Red Bull with me now. Ah, man. Explain that one. This is, distance works in very strange ways. their defense, their talking point, level confusion, talking point defense. I was trying to talk about the weather, but maybe they picked up, maybe this guy is like way more deep than the weather, you know, so maybe I, here, take a Red Bull and blast through your continuity talk so you don't, so you don't just sit, okay, let's be quiet here, let's just be quiet and sit in the now. No, no, here, have a Red Bull, have a Red Bull. have a Red Bull. I don't want you to be quiet. I'm afraid of quiet mind. I might have an epiphany and realize I can't disempower God or myself. I am God. All is God. All is empowered. Here, take a Red Bull. So I think in monastic culture, we probably won't have any Red Bull drinks. No energy drinks there. Or in an emergency, if I somehow get too tired and can't drive or something, I could always, in an emergency, I could use it, you know. It's, I understand the overall context of the situation. So, you know, in emergencies, pragmatically, in this situation, right, we have to be, still have to be pragmatic, right? So we're not fanatical, we're pragmatic. There's all sorts of other energy drinks, all covered full of them, you know. It had to give me a Red Bull. That was really, wow, some things at work here. Okay. So, a lot, we covered a lot, of course. And with this in monastic culture, this is what you do. This is what you do. And you realize, hey, I'm becoming super sophisticated and wise. And so this isn't retrogressive, you know, we're not regressing. This is not, you know, we're getting the job done. It's the world here that's regressing. It's the Red Bull world that's regressing. That is for sure. It's becoming farcical, actually. The world is becoming very farcical. And if you just look at it objectively, and from a, you know, clear standpoint, you just look at it, you just realize, This place is becoming insanely farcical. This is what some of the teachers tell us. Like Manchepa said, this world, people that confusing themselves in the most absurd ways is just totally absurd. Totally absurd. This is what they see. It's like just a total farce. But I don't think it's ever been this farcical in what's going on now. This is just... this is a delicious farce if you like farces, but I think we've gone far enough with the farces. You know, at some point there needs to be an end to that movie. I said, thank you for the laugh. I think that's enough. Everyone here's a great actress and actor, that's for sure. Genius farcical actors. Never seem to tire. Always can come up with some twist on it. It's absolutely amazing. But there again, you know, maybe we need to watch a different movie. You know, something not so farcical. So, all right, very great. Just keep pulling as fast as you can, but not, don't be blasty about it, right? Full stop in the now. Of this, wow, I can't disempower myself. And that's perfectly okay, because God did not create me with the mission to disempower myself. In fact, God created me perfectly free. So I'm free to try, I'm also free not to try. I'm equally free to choose anything I want to choose. Pure potential always is present with me. So I'm not stuck in this at all. So I don't need to worry about God getting angry with me. And there's no possibility of that. Things are looking a lot brighter, aren't they? And that's it.